I believe it's the appointed time, and I want to welcome you to our church. I'm pleased that you're able to come and visit with us. I understand we have a program today, and we also have some memorial booklets that have been made up, and we'll have refreshments downstairs, and I think we're going to have a hymn as well. Start with that, Betty?
Yes.
We have a brand new beautiful organ. It's all digital, and because it's digital, none of the controls are obvious to older folks. And so Betty and I were wrestling with it earlier today and managed to make some music.
I've got to tell you something before we get started. So, today we're going to try to think of funny things. And when I slid over here, made me think of when I was organist here. And the lady said, really cleaned our church. And they waxed this to if you wouldn't have it. And when I get up here, of course I'm always in a hurry, and I start sliding.
Oh no.
So I told them from then on, please don't touch that. Don't touch that. Okay, 435.
Betty, I'd like you to join with us, if you would, number 435.
Thank you.
me say at the beginning, in the Presbyterian tradition, the session actually runs the church, the pastor does not. And in a worship service, the things I'm allowed to do are select the scriptures and preach the sermon, and I get to select the music. Everything else is under the purview of the session. But I learned over the years not to pick the music because people get grumpy about their music. And after one service, when I heard a complaint again that we've never sung that song before, I said, "Really? Well, you bought this hymnal 20 years ago, and if you haven't sung that song, you're not getting your money's worth." And that didn't make the women happy, and so I got a little grumpy. I managed to hold it in pretty well, but on that particular Sunday, when three women assaulted me again about the music I had picked, I said, "Fine, you pick the music for the next four Sundays, you for the four after that, and you for the four after that." And so for the next quarter, if anybody complained, I'd say, "Talk to one of them, they picked it." And at the end of that quarter, I said to my trio, I said, "You ladies need to give me another month each." And I let them pick it, and I keep all of that on the computer, so it's the same call to worship on the same week of the liturgical calendar, and the same confession, and the same affirmation of faith, and now the same hymns. Since now that I have 12 months worth of approved hymns, I just don't change them, and if anyone should complain, I'd say, "It's not me." The blue one that was just made?
Yeah.
Okay. Linda, would you bring that one up, please? Now, I say that to say this, since this is not a worship service, I'm dressed for the part, but I'm really not in charge. Miss Betty is the one who's in charge of our program today, and she's prepared this booklet for you for after. You want to explain or introduce this?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Do you have a booklet?
So short.
Can you hear me? No, you can't.
You talk, I'll turn it up.
Hello, I'm trying to find my place here. Just a minute. Hello, preacher.
I had one turn. It gets a little hectic when you're getting this old assignment trying to do. But anyhow, we have a wonderful church here, a beautiful church. And I wanted to kind of give you the impression that of how I found it when I came into this church. I've been here for 55 years maybe. And I was not happy with the church I was going to, and I needed a change. So I did the deal here trying to find a church. We have a lot of people that's maybe trying to find a church and would welcome them. But anyway, I came on a link on a Lenten service night, and I sit back on there on the back seat because I wanted to just get it. Couldn't believe it was such a pretty church, and looked at it and felt like I was at home. And I thought, this is it. And then I had to tell my family, "Hey, we're changing churches, you know." But they liked it too. So anyway, okay. To tell more about the church, the architecture of this church really begins with the cornerstone. Remembering what the biblical description of Christ, the Christ cornerstone. And cornerstones are usually hollow and contain clippings or whatever, pictures and other items. Although it's not known whether the cornerstone contains anything, it is inscribed. And if anybody knows if there's something in the cornerstone, I bet that one of our two people here, Garcia or Kathy, would know. Do you know what's in it? Did you know what's in the cornerstone? No? Okay. So anyway, First thing that you look at when you come in is the Gothic brickwork over the front entrance, and the windows is known as the masonry arch. The graceful arch of the windows is really echoed in the carving on the front doors. The square bell tower, and I'll tell you more about that later, provides a contrast which is typical of many turn-of-the-century churches. The first room that we get into after we come into the big room out here is called the Narthex. It's a Greek name given to the entrance leading to the sanctuary. It's a practical buffer between the quietness of the sanctuary and the noise of the outside life. Now as we step into the sanctuary, we notice that the floor plan is laid out in the shape of a cross. Now you look. The arms. So in the shape of a cross. The ceiling beam point visually to the center, reminding us that our attention should be focused on God. And onto the choir rail, the pulpit, and the hanging light fixtures, we see once again the Gothic arch. We Presbyterians observe two sacraments into our worship, the baptism and the communion. And used in these sacraments are the baptismal font and the communion table. The baptismal font is carved in wood with a cross at the top. And during the sacrament, it's used to hold the water. The baptism, a symbol of the cleansing and regeneration. Baptism is symbolic of God's grace. Table represents the table used at the Last Supper. And if you look really carefully at it, it says, "Do this in remembrance of me." The communion table stands across and two candle holders. The empty cross signifies that Christ not only was crucified, but is risen. And the inscription IBS means Jesus, Son of God, the Savior, and it means the light of the world. Now, glass stain has been another medium for artistic places. A lot of our churches have them around. And during the great cathedral building around the 12th century, the greatest of those stained glass artists did their work. And there's modern artists in this field using the same methods. And you think, what did they use? Well, some of them had eggs and eggshells and blood and whatever made the right color, whatever lasted. Some member of First Presbyterian then had all of these windows as memorials. Now, we wanted to let you look at a different time. I'm going to pass these books out later so you can look at them. But I think we have three people that are still living that have their name in the windows. Garcia, is that right? Garcia, and her sister and Baggett or Born, I'm not sure which. And then the next thing that you're going to come to in this book is that we'll be talking about banners that we have up here. Now, that was quite an undertaking for our church women. And they, I don't know how many banners that we have for every different session of our programs. It'd be like, and then these have to be changed, and those have to be changed, and those have to be, those will be changed, because if they all focus in on one thought, what part of the Bible they're speaking from. And I had Terry Waldrop to draw these banners, and draw the pictures and the banners, so you would have pictures of each that, and going along with who gave them in memory of. Okay, when I think about the things that we started and developed along, I had a little chair choir, which did something funny about that too. I had 35 little ones from 4-year-old to 8. And this particular time, of course, as I bring them up, I wanted them to find their mama first and give them away, because they'd be so busy trying to find them all the time. I said, find your mama or your daddy and wave at them, and then you look at me. So they're all, this was over a little farther. They were all right in here, standing up there as nice as you please, and all of them was open, the eyes real big, and I thought, oh, it wasn't that here. One's got to go to the bathroom, not the bathroom. Maybe not.
Maybe not. Maybe didn't need to go to the bathroom. And finally, it dawned on me what had happened. Here's a spider. It's coming down right by my nose on this, and I thought, oh, when those kids see that, they're going to have a big fit. And I thought, what can I do? What can I do? I grabbed a handkerchief and kept their eyes. I said, watch me, watch me. And boom, like this, I'm coming down. And those kids never took a beat. I mean, even though they came in just when they were supposed to. But little things, so many things that's happened like that. And with the Christmas, three little boys that has to be wise men. Kathy will remember this. And what's his name? The little boy was a wise man. Carried an apple, and he started eating it. So he was eating it up there. And then it was Lily, the one that would get such a kick out of what the little boy was going to do. But anyhow, they were supposed to be up here and being very good, you know, standing up here. And all once he dropped to his feet, and I thought, what's the matter? And he was making out like he was a fish. And he was, okay. Grabbed him up, so we went along with it. And I guess one of the main things that happened here is the many times that I have come to the rescue with the organ, and then time we didn't have an organ, so I came in to substitute. I hadn't been here too long, and they found out that I played the organ, and the funeral director asked me if I would play for a funeral. And I thought, okay. So I was here on a Saturday, and I was really practicing. Here's a new organ, and new music, and new church, and my nerves weren't the best in the world. And I had my kids over at the preacher's house playing with their boys. Can you hear me all right? Is this loud enough? Can you hear? Okay. Anyway, I'm playing along and I'm practicing.
and all at once, things start moving. I mean, shaking and loud noises, like, I thought we'd been hit by a bomb. I mean, it was that loud. And then all at once I saw these chandeliers. You see those four chandeliers here? See them? They were hitting the ceiling. And I thought, I looked at that and I couldn't get up because everything was shaking so much. And I was having to hold on to the organ, to the whatever, and I thought, oh dear God, I'm never going to get out of this alive. So I run to the back, holding on to the piers as I went, and opened, we had a door that opened there, the first one there. And I opened that, and when I did, that whole bell tower fell in. If I would have been just seconds, I'd have been under that. So I slammed that, and I said, oh Lord, I've got to get out one more door to try. So then I tried that one and did okay, but walking through the sanctuary and seeing all of this stuff moving, and I thought, what's happening? What's going on? And then of course then I could tell it was still shaking and everything. And so I got outside and I could tell it was an earthquake. So then I thought, where's my boys? So I had to go next door, and just where they had been playing, that big window came in, broke in. So where, if they had not moved, they'd have been killed. So just thank you, Lord, for all that happened here. And
and the year?
Was that 1967?
70? It's 65 or 57.
I thought it was 67, November of 67.
Yes. Did you want to talk?
Okay.
What year? All right. I'm not too good at years anymore. Since I've been here, I've had three choirs. I chair a choir, and we had sometimes 50 kids in our group. And they could stay in until they went to the third grade. And they had to leave me to go up and hop in. Three of the students says they're not going to go up. They're going to stay in my class. And I said, well, but you've graduated. You're supposed to go on, you know. And I said, I don't want to go on. I want to stay with you. So I made a three school teacher, I mean teachers in my Sunday school that would not graduate. And they stayed. So I said, if you're going to stay, you're going to work down here. So they wanted to. But anyway, trying to think of some more of the gypsies here. I've been playing at the organ when the power goes off, and then what do? Well, you go down early and get with the piano, so no big deal. And what else? And Karen? Where are you? Think of anything else that happened in your time? We've been through so many apple butter making and trying to make some money for the church. And I've got so many things written in here that if you're interested in the history, you will see more things. And does anybody have a question for me? Yes? The pipes, they don't do anything. They're just there for it. That was with the first.
They're original to the church.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, one time they were acting silly at choir practice, and one of the men took one, so it was a long pipe down, blew on it. Oh, please don't break it. It had a sound. So anything else?
The organ used to sit back right where Michael is sitting.
Yes.
Remember the organ back
yes.
there? Yeah. And the pipes did work at that time.
Yeah. Now, I think You just did an update on the organ. I think this is our fourth one. So the church did not have an organ when it was built, and the pipe organ came in 1920. Was that the first one?
I couldn't find it in here.
Okay. I think in the 20s, the pipe organ came in, and then there have been two electronic ones before this one that came in just this year. So we've had several. So that's when the pipe organ stopped, was when we went to an electronic sometime in the 60s.
And it used to be facing the pipes.
They had a mirror. They looked at the congregation.
And then whoever was next, I don't know who that was, had it set here, facing there. And then had it there, facing this way. Oh, I've got to tell you one more.
When was the church first built?
1906 for this building. The church was organized in 1904 and began to have some meetings. But the building that we're in now went up in 1906.
It's all original from the 1906. Well, it's been remodeled.
Has been remodeled slightly. This kind of paneling was up in the back here originally. And at one point in the 70s or 80s, they took that out when they did the painting. And there's a Sunday school wing that's here, and that went up sometime in the 60s when they needed more space. And in the booklet, you'll see there was a picture of the parsonage that was next door. Many of you might remember that. When we added this addition with the new entrance and the elevator, that was wider than the alleyway, and it overlapped into the parsonage. So that's when that building came down to make room for the elevator and the new entrance. So yes, there have been some changes.
The original property that you had just maybe went one lot to the south?
Yes, it would have been just one to accommodate the manse. And now before I got here, I understand there were two or three homes, two. And when the church was able to buy those buildings and expand, that's what's now the parking lot. So the church was on one lot and the manse on another, and then there were other homes here. Phyllis.
Hallie Darnell?
Yes.
She's a short little lady, about as broad as she was tall. And she lived in the house next to the manse. And she and her husband, and then her daughter, Vera Davis, she and her husband and boys were members of the church. But she worked in the nursery for many, many years. And when the organ pipe was put in, the organ that went in at that time fit right underneath that center bunch of pipes. And it had mirrors on the side, like the car has mirrors you can see out. The organist, Elder Buell, could see out the audience. And she was the organist and the choir director. And that choir was full of people in the choir. Beautiful voices.
I have to tell you, my husband, Zane Healy, was a superintendent at the time and at the Sunday school. And of course, we had charge of the Sunday school. And playing the organ. Okay. I said, I'm not going to church there tomorrow. So Saturday, I said, I'm not going. Well, you have to go to play. I said, don't tell me what I got to do. I'm not going in that church. I said, you wouldn't either if you saw those things flying and hitting the ceiling. I said, it's not safe, Sam. Those banisters, those beams won't hold it. And he believed me, I guess, because I wasn't going. And he had to go down and get the state inspector to come down, give us the okay. Says, if it stood this long, it'll stand some more. Can you believe that? It was born on the anchor. So, anyway, that's the way. Okay, what else? Yes?
Reverend, you were a county pastor, having had since 1906.
Well, let me count quickly because, coincidentally, in the book that we prepared for you, we have all the names. If you have time to walk into our Sunday school classroom, the building adjacent here, we have pictures up of the previous pastors. But there have been, where do we have this? We're going to give you this booklet that has a list of all of the persons who have joined the church, a chronological list, so all of those names will be there, and many of the family names will be known to you.
And the banners?
I think we're close to a dozen, but let me see. Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. I'm the 17th pastor, but there are 18 because some of you remember a year ago I was recalled on active duty for a year and Tom Hobson filled in for me for that year. So 18 pastors have served the church.
Okay, and when I first got here, my husband and I helped with the teenagers or the Sunday school, meeting with them and fixing pizzas and all. And we had a very old stove. Zella, do you remember that old stove in the kitchen? Yes. Kathy's mother and father lived right across from the church at an office. And I don't know how many times I had to go down and carry my pizzas over there to her house to hurry up and finish baking them because that stove wouldn't work. And back and forth, but she is there handy to help me, so that was neat.
It was a big old iron church.
Yes.
Iron stove with, I think it could have had coal, you could put coal at one time, but it was electrified. But it took up a big space.
And then later on, I had the bell choir. We went to a church in here in Marion, and they had the little ones playing the bells, and oh, that fascinated me. So I had to have Zane buy me a group of those bells so we could hurry up and have them in our church. And we had those for a while, and they liked them, but they're sitting there not being used.
Not right now.
No, but we'll get them. And then we had, let's see what else, and we had just regular bells too that we played. So a lot of things to do in our church. We had so many things, got things now. We've got the new, the contemporary church, and it has different music, and it has different, what am I trying to say? A different format, and it's very nice and it's very enjoyable. And whenever they want to make money, they have the peanut butter, not peanut butter, apple butter. Apple, how many remembers the old style apple butter making? Yes. And so anyway, there's some more crafts, Christmas deals that they used to make. It was really something. I don't know what. Yes?
We used to have Bible school and went off to Sweden. And they have crafts. They have classes. And a lot of the older people that are in seats really helped out.
I remember when Reverend Hubbage was here. He always had to take the boys' class in Bible school, and it was his job to help them make a birdhouse.
So that's the only thing.
It's the only thing that was their job. So anyhow, we have a large place, not very large, but served 100.
I think in the coming year it'll be the 30th anniversary of serving the Lenten lunches and having those services in the community, and both the Heron Pantry and the pantry actually was begun by a pastor here in this church, and when it got too big to accommodate here, it became that community event that you're familiar with, and eventually now has its own building, as you know. I was happy to find that there's a bell here. I always like a church that has a real bell. And if you peek in the bell tower, you'll see that there are two ropes. One rocks a bell to toll it. I don't know if you've ever had a chance to look, but when I was a brand new pastor in a church with a real bell, I thought, Well, I'm the pastor. They can't tell me. I can't look. So I climbed up into the bell tower in Bemidji, Illinois, and was surprised to find that it's sort of like a wagon wheel beside the bell, and the rope wraps around it, and that gives you the leverage to rock it when you pull the rope, and that's how the bell actually tolls. And the smaller rope is for a hammer that strikes the bell from the outside. So if we wanted to toll the bell a specific number of times or at a particular cadence, we can pull that rope and toll the bell. And the church used to have a lift on the outside when I came, a mechanical lift, and that's what we replaced when we added the elevator. But when we did that and did a renovation for the platform there at that bell tower corner, we found the scars on the building for three different sets of stairs and stairways that had been there over the years, and a picture of one that apparently originally when you opened the doors you stepped down immediately, so the stairs were shorter and steeper, and there was an entrance into the basement in that corner. That's the one that still leaks if we get enough rainwater. They patched it somehow through the footing, and once in a while it still makes its contribution. So yes, there have been a number of renovations over the years, and if you talk to some of our members who have been here a long time, they have a number of stories. I heard one, I thought I'd heard them all, but just recently, I don't know if any of you have ever met a fellow in the community named Randy Lynn. All right, some of you apparently know him. Might not be surprised to find that he told me the story of adding this addition when he was younger, and the Masons had a big pile of sand, and the boys discovered that before the windows were in, they could run out the window from the second story and jump onto the sand pile, and it was a great deal of fun. But they discovered that as Masons actually mixed the cement, they used the sand. So the building got taller as the sand pile got shorter. They said the last fellow jumped into about 2 inches, and they decided that wasn't much fun after that, so they stopped. And so along with the changes here in this building, then you're also familiar with the fact that this was the Stotler Lumber Building, and before I came, so about 14 years ago, they purchased that, and that's now the site for our contemporary service. And you remember the various businesses along the street here. And as each of those became available, then the church now owns all of those lots. And we are now just talking about what we might do with that and if we need a parking lot or a separate building or something. I reminded them that I'm getting old and I would like to retire in 10 years or so. And this would be a good time to talk about what the future of the church is so that if we need to make some change or renovation, we can have that accomplished before the next pastor comes. So we are still looking forward, even though we've been here 113 years now. If I did the math correctly on my time and the age of the church, I believe I've been here for 13% of the church's history so far. And if I retire at 68, I can make 20%. And that'll be a tough record for anyone to beat. So I came at just the right time. Is there anything else we need to talk about?
I hope you can explain why you didn't get your picture.
When you pick up the booklet, what she's actually done is copy the pages from a previous history book with the pictures of the pastors that were in that one. So we do have photographs for Doug Noggle and Joe Van Roekel, Steve Thayer, and Jack Seibert in the library if you'd like to wander into the library room and look at those. And my picture isn't up there, nor is Tom Hobson's, and so we're going to have to catch up. In fact, I think I might be wise to do that this year because in the years between now and my retirement, I'm not sure if there'll be any hair left. I might take a picture when I'm still looking pretty. So
I was telling these are so pretty.
Is someone going to guide us around to where the library is?
I would be happy. I think we have refreshments downstairs, and I'd be happy to walk people through to the other part of the building to show you the rooms there and the pictures in that library room. And if you'd like to go next door to see how the renovation was done at the contemporary building, I'm happy to open that up for you as well. Anything else?
Michael, I've got a little humorous story. We always had active children here in the church, and one year I was asked to be the superintendent, so for 2 years I was superintendent of the Bible school. So we made our headquarters in the kids, and that way the people kind of would reflect. So Reverend Covey's was the minister, and we were outside, and this young student climbed out of one of the windows and they had taken them out onto, and on the rod, they had a rod for the Jennifer Victoria outside here. So Reverend Covey said, well, they there, so and so, I wouldn't say the name, they can be very common, professional man in town.
Yes.
My husband, as a boy, rang the bell.
Ah.
He wants to know if he can bring it.
Absolutely. In fact, when you have children who are the right age, I let them ride the bell. And what I do is I put the bell rope around them as if it's a swing, and I let them ride it up and down, because I think there's only a particular time in your life when you can make those memories. I'm not going to let any of you do it today, for example. So when we have children the right size, we do that. Let me tell one story to close us. It was you made me think of it when you said about not wanting to go into the building after seeing the earthquake, but I heard of a fellow who woke up one morning and said to his wife, "I don't think I'm going to church today." And she said, "You have to go." And he said, I don't want to go." She said, "You have to go." And he said, "All right, give me three good reasons why I should go." And she said, "Well, number one, you're a Christian. Every Christian should be in church. Number two, your friends are there and they like to visit with you on Sunday morning. And number three, you're the pastor." And so with that story in mind, I've been very good in my attendance over the years. So we're pleased to have you with us here this morning. And if you come on any particular Sunday, you'll probably find me here as well. We'd be happy to see you back.
One more story about, we have Camp Peru, a camp on the grassy lake, and we always took the young group, high school group down there to stay all night on Saturday night on Easter, and always give the program. So anyway, is Bill Smith here today? I don't see Bill. The kids wanted to learn how to do the canoes. Okay. So, of course, he says, "I know how to do this. Let me be the boss." Okay, so he took them out, you know, and he was showing what to do, what not to do. But we're up here on a hill, and he's down here in the water, and all at once, first splash, he turns it over. He doesn't have any clean clothes. The only boy that was there weighed about 300 pounds. So anyway, we won't forget that. He knew how to ride that to teach canoeing. Okay.
That's it.
That's it.
Okay.
Turn it over to Phil.
We want to thank everyone for coming today, and we've actually got a couple of new members in the audience today also. And I would like to recognize a visitor that's come from the edge of the desert in Texas to be with us today. And some of you might know her aunt was Caroline Bowie, who used to teach at Southside. And I think I'd like for you to stand and introduce yourself and tell us. You have a connection with this church. Was it grandmother or mother? Carolyn? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Also, this has been the summer classic church tour of the historical side of you, and that's kind of what we're doing this summer. And the next one will be on July 12th, and it'll be the Methodist Church. And Marie Samuels, would you? Do you have anything you want to mention about that?
Oh, we'll be upstairs. There's an elevator. We'll try to have a balloon or a scarf or something, so we go to the side and we use the elevator instead of climbing the front stairs. We hope to sit there over there.
And then the third one will be Our Lady of Mount Carmel, and that will be on Friday, July 26th. Does that, anyone have any information on that, or that's correct, right?
I hope all of you will come because the Catholic Church has had this huge new renovation, and if you haven't seen it, it's truly a beautiful place, and it's very historic like this one is and the one that we're going to see on Friday. Monsignor Schaefer will be the presenter, and then two parishioners will actually share, as Betty has, with some of the historical families that were part of it. We're so glad that all of you came. I hope you go home and tell other people to join us in the next two presentations. Also, and Phil probably may or may not mention it, but August 2nd, we have a wonderful speaker coming from Metropolis, and he'll speak about shipbuilding during the Civil War. He was also the
and that'll be at the Heron Library, August 2nd at 2 p.m. Also, there'll be tours of the Harrison House and the historic complex at John A. Logan, and I think that'll be at 10 o'clock and 1 o'clock on Tuesday, July 9th. Is that correct? And everyone's invited for that. But that's what we've got going this summer. We hope you all support us. These three churches were chosen because of the historic interiors that is still there, and a lot of times we just don't have a chance to enjoy what we have here in Heron, and we want to make it well known to everyone. I want to thank Lisa Carnegie from the Heron Library, she's also a member, for coming here and filming this today. Our programs for the past 2 years have been filmed, and they can be checked out through the Heron Library or through your local library, interlibrary loan
right.
program.
Exactly.
And I would really want to say thank you to Betty for all the work that she's done today. We do have a booklet that you pick up down by the sign-in table as you leave today, Be One for Family. And we have cookies, and cookies upstairs, and we certainly need some help with those. So make sure that you come down and enjoy that, and enjoy touring the church. And Betty, as always, a lovely job. Betty did our the first lecture of, when we started up doing these historic lectures at the library on wondering schools, and she also did one on the Crab Orchard Lake area and the refuge and how that came to be and some of the families that used to be there. We do have a few of her booklets that she prepared for that, and if anyone would like to purchase one, just let us know. Also, we have newsletters that come out once a month, and there's a few extra copies down at the table. It costs us about $2 to produce them, so if you see one you didn't get, and we have an extra one, you're welcome to purchase that. But thank you so much.